Revelation, as I've said before, is the principal book of prophecy in the New Testament of the Bible.
David with Gerald Fleury.
Greetings, everyone. Romans 8 and verse 23 is one of the most misunderstood translations in the King James Bible. And it's misunderstood mainly because they simply found it too awesome to even believe what is printed in the original Greek. Now, if you get back to the original Greek, you'll see how splendid and majestic and even transcendent this verse is about man's potential. And it's something that's not, well, it's very profound, not easy always to understand, but if you do understand it, it's just absolutely mind-staggering. And it's about your potential. It's about my potential. It's about our potential. And yet, it's one of the most misunderstood verses in all the Bible. I mean, most people just simply are deceived about it. And I want to show you that and show you why this verse is mistranslated. It does tell us about our potential. And that is so incredible that the translators, they could not believe what God was telling them about their own potential. Now, there's a second reason why it's misunderstood, and that's because there's an evil spirit in this world who hates that subject more passionately than you can even imagine. And there's a reason why. And I talked about that quite a lot last week on television and explained that to you. And if you didn't hear that program, we'll send you a free DVD of that program so you can understand some of the background of what I'm talking about today. But these verses are very majestic and profound, and it does take some study and some thought to really understand them. And they're given very little of that today. Notice what it says in Romans 8 and verse 19. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility. This is from the Revised Standard Version. Not of its own will, but by the will of Him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay. Now, it's talking about the whole universe being in bondage to decay, well, it's just like you see Mars and the moon and how they are in bondage to decay. And God never, ever creates anything in a state of decay. So what happened? What happened? What is Paul talking about here in Romans? Why is the universe in decay? Well, because of Satan and his rebellion, again, which I talked about last week. And there may be, well, there are millions of those angels, and maybe even billions of them. And I explained how that when they rebelled, they did just, well, really just totally wrecked the earth. And I'll show you a little bit more about that momentarily, or a little later. But they also did severe damage to the entire universe, and you can see it. It's in a state of decay. And God would never create anything in that state. Never. Notice it goes on in verse 21. Well, I'll read that again, part of it, because the creation, not the creature, as it says in the King James, the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and obtain the glorious liberty of the children of God. Verse 22, we know that the whole creation has been groaning and travailed together until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait for adoption as sons through a resurrection, redemption of our bodies. So here is the word that is very much mistranslated, and that is the word adoption is not in the original Greek. And I'm going to read it to you from the Moffat translation so you'll understand what this word really means. Here's what the Moffat translation says about the last part of that verse. But even we ourselves who have the Spirit as a foretaste of the future, even we sigh deeply to understand as we wait for the redemption of the body, that means our full sonship. Not adoption, but full sonship. Now, why is that so important? Because we're going to be born into the family of God in a full sonship. We're not adopted. We're born into the God family just like a child today is born into the physical family. It's about a birth. All of this is about a birth, and they made a mistake of the greatest magnitude, because this is what the gospel is all about. We are waiting for the full sonship, not the adoption, that is a resurrection from the dead, and being born into the family of God. And this is a mistake of great magnitude, because it's about the God family and how we're born into it as full sons, not adopted at all. Or if we were just adopted, well, God could never recreate Himself in an adopted son, but He could in a son with full sonship. And there's a big difference. And you'll have to do a little studying to understand that more deeply, but we'll give you the material you need to do so. Just as my two children were born into my family, the Fleury family, and they were born into it, and that is a type of our being born into the family of God. It's an exact type. That's why God created it that way. But see, look, if Satan was angry and really did severe damage to the universe anciently, before man was even created, well, today he has been cast down and now is confined to this earth and full of wrath because he knows he has but a short time, and he hates this plan of God's family and men being born into that family more than anything else, because it is the gospel. And he does hate that, and he never was given the opportunity to be born into the family of God. Only those that are going to have God recreated in them can have that honor. So today, Satan hates just with the fiercest kind of wrath the plan to have man born into that family. You go ahead and read verses 24 through 26. Well, maybe I can just quickly read them. For in this hope we were saved. Now, hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. There's, in two verses, five hopes. This is just absolutely full and brimming over with hope for man. This is where the hope is, right here. And man understands it so little. You can look at verses 16 and 17 where it says we're going to be joint heirs with Christ. Joint heirs. He was the Son of God, and we become sons of God. And those called out before Christ's second coming will marry Jesus Christ and be His wife. You can't be his wife if you are not a full son or have a full sonship. Look what Mr. Armstrong wrote. What an amazing, marvelous revelation of knowledge. No more amazing, awesome, eye-opening passage could be written, talking about those verses I've just read to you. Christ is the firstborn of many brethren, it says, of many brothers. He's the firstborn. And he's now a son of God. And we're also a son of God. That's what his first coming taught us very clearly. But again, if you're joint heirs with him, with Christ, I mean, that's just mind-splitting to think about. Well, we're going to be joint heirs with Jesus Christ. I mean, this is what it means when you talk about God recreating himself in man so he can renew the universe and beautify the universe, which is where Satan and the angels failed. Now that honor is given to man, but only God himself can be trusted to do that, so he had to recreate himself in man. And I can show you many scriptures telling you about that, and we will. We'll give you all kinds of literature so you can understand this in detail. Mr. Armstrong wrote, what are we going to do then? Well, these scriptures indicate we shall impart life to billions and billions of dead planets as life has been imparted to this earth. Wow, that's tremendous. That's the most glorious mission any work could ever have. There's no mission greater than that. None. Well, last week, I talked to you about God sending Lucifer and one-third of the angels to this earth to rule over it. They were tested to see whether or not they could do that job. They had to be tested. They were going to beautify and bring the universe to a certain level of life even then, but not on the same level that we'll be able to do in the very near future. But Lucifer and the angels rebelled, and they rose up and tried to overthrow God. And that's when the earth was wrecked and when the universe was just terribly damaged. And you can see that damage even today. All we have to do is look at those pockmarked planets out there, and we know that they're in a bondage to decay, God says. Well, why? Well, because of that rebellion. Satan and Lucifer and his demons, or angels at the time, sinned against the government of God. It was the government of God that they could not implement. And God said, well, I can't use them to rule over the universe and beautify it because they didn't pass the test here on this earth. God saw at that time that only he could be trusted to renew and rule over the universe and even rule with him and with Christ, that only by him recreating himself in man could man fulfill that responsibility. And that's when he had to send his son to this earth and make the greatest sacrifice that man has ever known. God saw that he had to raise it to a much higher level. Notice Hebrews 1, verses 2 and 3. This is from the Moffat translation. A son whom he, God, has appointed heir of the universe, as it was by him, Christ, that he, God, created the world. He, reflecting God's bright glory and stamped with God's own character, sustains the universe with his word of power. So all things there means universe in the King James. But the Moffat says universe because that's what it's all about. It's about the universe. And then it says this about Christ being made so much better than the angels, as he had by his inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, you are my son? It's talking about Christ, but did God ever say to the angels, you are my son? No, he never did. Did he ever say it to men? Yes, he has. He's going to continually say it to them. When they are begotten by the Holy Spirit, they are the sons of God and the family of God in embryo already. This is talking about our potential. We are called sons of God, but he makes it clear here that the angels were never called that because they were never sons. This is talking about a full sonship. Somebody just literally born right into the family of God because they're sons now in embryo, in the womb, spiritually speaking, waiting to be born, not adopted. You have to see the whole picture here. Well, Christ was not the Son until he came to this earth, and then he became the Son, and the God became the Father. And that was all done to open up the family of God so that God could recreate himself in men. Now, that ought to just about knock us flat with wonder and joy, because that's what God is offering mankind. And the Bible is filled with it, that message. Just filled with it. You can see that over and over and over again, but there's a giant leap when you go from man to God, being a son of God. I mean, that's a huge leap. And God had to create his greatest creation, the greatest creation he could possibly even create. And how amazing that is. But he's put this world in subjection. Hebrews 2 and verse 5, I'll read it. For unto the angels has he not put in subjection the world to come, whereof we speak. No, now he's put it in that world that's coming, that beautiful world that's coming. He's put it in subjection to man, if he will yield himself to God. See, Satan, Lucifer and the angels were created as spirit beings, and the spirit can't die. So God created men out of mud so that they, when they die, they can die. And he can, those that follow him and obey him can be made sons of God, though, and become eternal beings. Verse 8, you have put all things, now it should be the universe in subjection under the man's feet, for that he, God, put all in subjection under him, that God left nothing that is not put under him. All things, the whole universe, left nothing that is not under him. That's everything. Everything you see in that wonderful universe, that mighty creation of God, it's all going to be under man as he's ruled by God the Father and the Son, Jesus Christ. That's the entire universe. But you see the last part of that verse 8, it says, before you think, well, I can't believe that, it says, now we see not yet all things, that is the endless universe, put under him. It hasn't happened yet. But it's going to happen. And then he says in verse 10 and 11, for it became him for whom all things, the entire universe, and by whom are all things, and bringing many sons unto glory. Bringing many sons to glory, not adopted sons. He's going to bring you to glory, and you're going to look like him, and you're going to think like him, and you're going to have the character of God. I mean, that's something that's just truly mind-boggling. Think about that sometimes when you have a little extra time, and I tell you, it will change your life. He said he had called them, he's not ashamed to call them brethren or brothers or family, call their all sons. But the angels were never created to be sons of God. And think about what God is offering us. Think about what he is offering mankind. Let's go now to Genesis 1 and verse 1, and we'll see about this in the beginning period. Genesis 1 and verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It should read heavens. This is not about the time the earth was created. This is actually just a renewing of the surface of the earth after Lucifer rebelled. That's what it's about. But then it says, it used for the word heaven, it should be heavens or the universe. Again, you see, men cannot understand that. They just can't bring themselves to believe that God is giving man so much. It's just too much for their minds. They can't believe it, but it's true. Notice verse 2, and the earth was, or should be, became without form and void. Without form and void are translated from the Hebrew, tohu and bohu. A better translation is waste and empty, or chaotic and in confusion. You can see, well, let me just read this paragraph from Mr. Armstrong, what is described from verse 2 on in the supposed creation chapter of the Bible, quote unquote, did occur, according to the Bible, approximately 6,000 years ago. But that could have been millions or trillions of years after the actual creation of the earth described in verse 1. How many people know that? Not many. But you see, it was the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light, and God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And you read Psalm 104 and verse 30, it says there, I'll just let you read that later, you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. God had to renew the face of the earth. Well, why? Well, because of Satan's rebellion, and because he just absolutely, totally destroyed this earth and made it look like some kind of a swamp or a sewage running into all kinds of tributaries. It was just a mess, terrible, terrible mess. Now let's go on and read, though, verses 24 through 26. And God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing and beast of the earth after his kind. And it was so. And God made the beast of the earth after his kind and cattle after their kind and everything that creeps upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. God made animals after the animal kind. And he made man after the God kind. Man is not an animal. And yet so many people believe he is because they can't believe what God says in his Bible. There is no animal that has the potential that a man has to be born in the family of God who has a God-like mind. And if you read verse 26, that likeness is that we look like God today. We look like God, and that image means in God's character and in his mind, created in with the mind of God and the very character of God. That's what it's all about. Can you believe that? That's why men are here on this earth. That's why that universe is out there, that splendid, miraculous universe created by the Almighty God, but his greatest creation of all that even he can perform is recreating himself in man. Just let me give you a few scriptures to read. Philippians 3 and verse 21, Psalm 17, verse 15, 1 John 3, verses 1 and 2, where it tells you clearly that we're going to look like God and be in the God family as sons. And many scriptures tell you that. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 through 53. And Romans 6 and verse 5. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 49. These are all scriptures you ought to read because they tell you about your potential in an amazingly wonderful way. I'm telling you, this creation that I'm talking to you about is the most colossal, tremendous thing that the Almighty God has ever, ever done. Recreate himself in man. Until next week, this is Gerald Fleury. Goodbye, friends.
Reading the Bible is mind-staggering, especially in the depth God originally inspired. Many people, even Bible translators, misunderstand what the Bible says, particularly when it comes to mankind's potential. Do you know why man was created? Do you know why you were born? The Bible contains the answers. You need to learn what the Bible says about your incredible potential. You need to learn why you exist. Many people ignore these fundamental questions, but the Bible will show you why you are here. To find out more about what the Bible says, request our Key of David reprint article, Creation, Subject to Futility, but in Hope. This excerpt was originally written by Herbert W. Armstrong the day that the first images in history were transmitted from the surface of another planet. Mr. Armstrong tells the story of watching these first images come through to an audience in Ambassador Auditorium in Pasadena, California. Mr. Armstrong asks the fundamental question that the scientists didn't ask: why are these planets here? He also answers that question from your own Bible. You can learn much more about why these planets are here and why you exist with our two free booklets, God is a Family and Just What Do You Mean? Born Again. Also, be sure to request your free subscription to the Philadelphia Trumpet News Magazine. This magazine will show you how current headlines tie into Bible prophecy. Don't miss our latest issue with Gerald Fleury's article, The Significance of Germany's Break from America. Other articles include Putin Won't Just Survive, He'll Thrive. And How Bad Is California's Record Drought? Request our Key of David reprint article, Creation, Subject to Futility, but in Hope. You can learn much more about why you exist with our two free booklets, God is a Family and Just What Do You Mean? Born Again. Also, be sure to request your free subscription to the Philadelphia Trumpet News Magazine.